Welcome back, everyone. Today, less than 1% of vaccines used in Africa are manufactured locally. This means that African countries are reliant on imports to immunize their people, including against long-standing diseases like polio and newer scourges like COVID-19. In order to address these issues, the African Union has set a goal to develop, produce, and supply at least 60% of its vaccines within the continent by 2040. What can we do now to ensure that vaccines are increasingly produced on the ground in Africa, ready for quick deployment? Today's guest, Patrick Tippoo, is a renowned expert on the subject. Patrick is the Chief Science and Innovation Officer at South Africa-based Biovac, where he's responsible for vaccine product development. He is also a founding member and the executive director of the African Vaccine Manufacturing Initiative, AVMI, which advocates for the establishment of vaccine development and manufacturing capacity in Africa. Patrick, thank you so much for speaking with us today, and welcome to WIPO.
Thank you so much for having me.
So I'd like us to jump right into the deep end. And my first question for you is, what is it going to take to develop a sustainable vaccine manufacturing ecosystem in Africa? And why hasn't it previously happened?
That's a very, very tough question. I think let me answer the last part of it first. So why hasn't it happened to date in Africa? And I think the simple answer is that vaccine development and vaccine manufacture is extremely complex. It's technically complex. The regulatory environment required to enable vaccine development and production is complex. The financing of vaccine infrastructure is complex because it's required over a long period of time with very little return on that investment over the initial years. So in essence, what I'm saying is that the challenges are enormous, and that's why it hasn't happened to date. But I think what is required to make it happen is that that has already started, by the way. So what we need to continue now is build on what we've initiated through the Partnership for African Vaccine Manufacturing, which in essence is the bringing together of multiple stakeholders to work on this challenge and turn it into an opportunity to build this capacity in Africa and contribute to socioeconomic development as well.
Now I'd like to zoom in for a more IP-specific question for you. And I would love to know, what is the role of IP in supporting diversified vaccine production? So not just of COVID-19, but of other vaccines that are used across the continent. And how is the African Vaccine Manufacturing Initiative approaching its IP strategy?
So if one zooms out from that question just for a bit, then when we talk about IP, obviously IP is a big basket has a big basket of elements to it. But essentially, we're talking about know-how, the ability to do something, the knowledge to apply that to the vaccine process, and then create that into product. And it starts with patents, but it extends into basic know-how, in-house know-how. So I think the strategy contains several elements. One is access to technology transfer partnerships. How do we enable that? How do we incentivize that in a more productive way on the continent? Because it's through these linkages and partnerships that access to the knowledge and the freedom to operate through these partnerships are then provided. So I think that is pillar number one, access to the technology transfer partnerships. I think the other component relates more specifically to patents, and we understand that it's the patent framework globally and and locally in countries that enable the investment in R&D that leads to these novel products and novel technologies as well. So with respect to the patent side of it, I think it's critically important that that is protected. But in emergency situations, there ought to be an understanding of how those patents are going to be relaxed to enable diversified manufacturing and also scaled up manufacturing. So those are the two sides of the coin.
I'm going to ask you a tough one now. Can African vaccine manufacturers be cost competitive? And feel free to chop this up into short term, medium term, and long term in your response.
So with respect to African vaccine manufacturers becoming cost competitive, and this talks to access to market, and I think African governments and the likes of UNICEF and Gavi have a huge role to play in ensuring that African providers or manufacturers are provided with an opportunity to access the market. Now, initially, there needs to be an interim solution that is provided to African vaccine manufacturers, because initially they cannot be cost competitive, because they would have to ramp up to build the economies of scale. So there needs to be some kind of premium that is agreed on, and obviously this need to be funded in a committed way. But this premium, some people call it a resilience premium, needs to be agreed on so that it provides the runway for the African vaccine manufacturers to build up to a state of competitiveness over a period of 10 years or more, so that the playing field can be leveled. So this resilience premium, I think, is going to be a critical success factor in enabling this capacity to be built on the continent as well.
I'd like to shift away a little bit, specifically from the COVID-19 area, and speak about another disease, which is cholera. And sadly, over the past year, there have been a number of cholera outbreaks, including on the African continent. Unfortunately, simultaneously, there has been a shortage of cholera vaccine. Now, of course, the happy news is that we know that last November, BioVac concluded a licensing and technology transfer agreement with the International Vaccine Institute to manufacture oral cholera vaccine. I would love to hear more about this, because I think this really brings us into the realities of tech transfer and whether they look different in an emergency or pandemic situation from kind of more business as usual.
I think the components of a technology transfer remain consistent, whether it's in an emergency situation or a more relaxed situation. Obviously, in an emergency situation, time is of the essence. But generally speaking, for a manufacturer, time is of the essence, because the time to market costs money. However, in an emergency situations, we have the benefit of all key stakeholders working together in sync. And that creates the efficiencies, and that creates the fast tracking to get to market. So from a technology transfer activity perspective, it is no different. We all have to step through those processes. I think that obviously when we are in an emergency, we can then, there's a reason for the players to get together around the table and then come up with creative solutions to how the timelines can be expedited. So I think the emergency situation forces us to have those conversations, because there are competing priorities all the time. Regulators are bombarded, they're overwhelmed. So they have to have a way of prioritizing which projects, which products get their attention and what the order of that priority is. So I do think that, coming back to the oral cholera vaccine, And the BioVac collaboration with IVI is a groundbreaking situation because for the first time, we will be developing a vaccine in Africa, which will be tested in Africa. The clinical trial material will be manufactured in Africa, and it will receive local registration through a national regulatory authority. That is ML3, approved by WHO, and then proceed on to achieve WHO pre-qualification. And so through this one intervention, a focused intervention on oral cholera, and as you say, it's becoming a priority disease now because of outbreaks. It's a coming together in quite a fortuitous way of a number of different tracks merging to produce this outcome, which fits in with the overall plan and strategy for the continent as well.
So this really ties into my next question, Patrick, which is, are we going to be more prepared for the next big one? Are we going to be more and better prepared for the next pandemic? And what does that look like from the many different viewpoints? And I know, you know, because of your roles, you can speak from the viewpoint of a manufacturer, but also an international vaccine initiative. But also, what would that look like maybe from a government viewpoint as well?
So again, the simple answer is yes, we are more prepared. Are we prepared enough? That I think is debatable. And I would say we still have a distance to go to be prepared sufficiently to respond to a future outbreak, a future significant outbreak. I think manufacturers have a part to play in this, and they're beginning to do so already by advancing their capability, investing in infrastructure, developing the workforce, and also entering into technology transfer partnerships that, as we discussed earlier, accelerates that capability building. I think the regulators on the continent and also initiatives like the African Medicines Agency are good starting points for the regulatory stakeholders to ensure that they are more enabled and better prepared through workforce development, through systems, and through processes, and also degrees of harmonization and reliance between regulators. I think politicians have a huge role to play in that they have a prime seat around the table in terms of ensuring that the capacity building is incentivized through policy and structure. This needs to be embedded, because if it's not embedded through policy and structure, it will disappear once the harsh noonday sun comes up. And so governments have a responsibility to ensure that their policy development takes place quickly and is coherent across government departments as well. From a procurement perspective, governments have a huge role to play, self-procuring countries in Africa, as well as those reliant on Gavi and UNICEF for their supply. So I think that this demands a concerted effort from a group of stakeholders to make it happen. But I think we have had a good start. We have had a fierce prod in the ribs to do something through COVID, and now it remains to be seen whether we're going to go the distance. I'm optimistic that if enough of us keep this flag waving, we will push across the finishing line.
My final question, Patrick, is perhaps the most timely. IP in support of innovation, equity, and access to health technologies. Does it look different in a pandemic or emergency situation to the normal business as usual?
Our view is that it should look different. That in an emergency situation, it demands that priorities change and perspectives change, because we have a unique situation to deal with, which requires creative ways and different ways of thinking. So that which we have applied in the past, I don't think can extend into pandemic or other outbreak situations. And there needs to be a mix of things, as I've argued before. The incentivization and mechanisms in place to enable technology transfer partnerships, but also for companies who own key pieces of intellectual property to at least create the freedom to operate, to create the space for others to utilize the intellectual property so that we can scale up production in the fastest possible time so that product can get to where it's needed most. When we're over the peak of that, then we can reconsider and review it and say, okay, now we can sort of move towards business as usual again. But I do think it demands a better way of approaching this in a pandemic situation.
Patrick, thank you so much for your time and your insights.
It's my pleasure. And once again, thanks for inviting me.
Well, that was absolutely fascinating. What are your thoughts on vaccine development in Africa? Let us know in the comments and give this video a like. It would really mean a lot to us. And if you've made it this far and haven't yet subscribed to our channel, please hit the subscribe button now, turn on the bell notification, and you won't miss a single one of our new videos. Thanks so much for watching, and I'll see you in the next one. Bye for now.